Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. We are glad that you're here for worship this morning. I want to thank our elders for this creativity. This is actually an approved solution so that those who are leading out in the service don't have to suffer through a mask all the time. And so I believe it was John and Dave who basically built this, and Vern too. Okay. And so thank you, fellas, for putting this together, and we're going to give it a go and see how it works. So we're glad that it's in place and we can do this. We're glad to see all of you and hope you're staying healthy and safe, not only from COVID, but from the smoke. If it's not one thing, it's something else, right? Interesting times. But what's that? I can't hear anymore in this thing. This is, it's like I'm in a time warp up here, but it's, I just want to let you know, just one announcement really. Next Sunday, we're going to be gathering around the Lord's table together. For you who are here, we will provide pre-filled elements for you. For you who are at home, it would be good if you had something, cracker, juice, something available before you come to watch the service so that you can be prepared to take part in the Lord's table as well. So just a heads up for next Sunday, that's what we're going to be doing together. So we're grateful for that ability as well. I hope everybody's doing well. Like I said, it's good to see you. Even from inside a fishbowl, as Dave calls it, it's good to see you. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. So now I invite you to stand, if you are able, as we worship together in song.
Good morning, good morning. It's good to see you all out. Realize that you are an integral part of the service this morning. Any fewer and we'd meet in this parking lot probably. Let's pray. Father, thank you for who you are and what you mean to us. Thank you for your guidance and direction this past week, for your safety, for keeping us free from the pandemic virus that's so affecting our country. We pray that you would be with us this morning. Father, we claim your presence in our presence this morning. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Speak to us through our pastor. Strengthen him, encourage him, and may this service be a blessing to have been in part of this morning. For we ask it in our precious Savior's name. Amen.
God is love, for God so loved the world, the whole world, not just my world. God so loved every person in this world and sent Jesus to teach us what love looks like.
Pyar, c'est une chile hota hai.
L'amour n'a pas de fin.
El amor no es envidia.
Liefde pronkt niet.
Любовь не гордится.
사랑에는 실패가 없다.
L'amour, pas égoïste.
딩 yêu sẽ chẳng dễ dàng nóng giận.
Yegarik sẽ knai to ka ko pue khun kani.
Premlai dushtma prasanna gardaina.
El muhabba tefra fil haq.
Bhalobasha shorboda rokha kore.
Amour sempre confirma.
Liebe sucht nicht seinen eigenen Vorteil.
Amour toujours persévère.
Since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. To love every person, every nationality, every background, every history, every soul. Because in life we find faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
Stop.
We've been thinking about the various ways that God's presence is with us. All through those middle chapters of Romans, we saw God's sovereignty. In Psalm 23, last time, we saw God's comfort. This morning, we're going to think about God's love to us. And for the scripture reading, we're going to go back to Romans chapter 8, but for the message, we're going to be all over the place. So again, I hope you brought your fast-turning Bible with you. But we're going to read from Romans 8. What a grand treatise on God's love. When you find that, if you would stand in the honor of reading the word of the Lord. Romans chapter 8, beginning at verse 28. Romans chapter 8, beginning at verse 28. I hope by now you know this. As Paul writes, we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified, and those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? Since God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, yes, who was raised and who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is demonstrated in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank you. That deserves the loudest. We should be blowing the roof off this place. That's right. Nothing can separate us from the love of our God. Let's bow before our Lord again in prayer. Before I break the silence, which I've just done, just contemplate that for a minute. There is nothing, no COVID, no fire smoke, no weird school year, no economic struggle. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Think about that. That is a profound thing, our Father. We've been singing of your love for us all morning, meaningful words. I pray those words stay with us a long time, such as how we were just sinking deeper and deeper and deeper because of our sin. And through Christ, you came and lifted us up and rescued us, all because of your divine love. A love we can't truly comprehend because it's just beyond anything we've ever known or anything we see or anything we even do. And yet your scripture says you proved, you demonstrated, you acted out your love for us while we were still sinning against you as Christ died for us. And of course, as you raised him from the dead for us, giving victory over sin and death. Giving hope beyond just this life. It does get better than this. So much better for those who know you and love you and are called according to your purpose. So in this time of uncertainty and struggle and challenge and confusion and even doubt with all the stuff going on, reassure us today through through your scriptures as this magnificent theme of your love is opened up again and brought before us. Remind us all over again of how profound your love is. And yet, even in your love for us, it's not all about us. It's all about you. It's not about our plan. It's about your plan. And so I pray that our time spent with you in worship this morning will just deepen and enlarge in our thoughts about how much you love us, so that we are comforted and our confusion is minimized, our doubts are put to rest, and we walk out of here understanding all over again what an incredibly loving God you are. So, Father, it's a joy to come to you in worship today, even in the midst of fire, smoke, and COVID and everything else, masks and all. What a thrill to be able to be here and worship you today. What a thrill that others can do it remotely and join with us. Thank you. Thank you for your great love. It's in the name of your Son, our Savior, that we pray. And everybody said, amen. The true story about the Swiss theologian Karl Barth. He actually began his life as a rather humanistic theologian, but over time and over his own study, God really opened his eyes to see the truth. Toward the end of his life, nearing his retirement, he decided to take a trip all around the world. It was part lecture tour, part personal reflection and sabbatical. He visited with a lot of the great thinkers, theologians, philosophers, whoever had time for him. Went to a lot of the great universities, visited a number of the great cathedrals around the world. When he returned home, back in those days, reporters actually were interested in what theologians thought. And so a reporter stopped him as he got back to the States and says, "Tell us, Dr. Barth, with all your travel and all your study and all your writing and everything you've done, what is the most profound, the greatest thought you've ever had? What's the greatest truth you've ever discovered?" Without a pause, he said, "The greatest truth I know is that Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so." The most profound thought from a profound mind. He died in 1968. Today, 5 decades later, there are realities that have caused even some Christians to wonder, does he love me? Can I know this? I mean, there have been tsunamis and earthquakes and tornadoes and hurricanes that have wiped out entire communities, killing tens of thousands of people. The terrorist attacks of 9/11 were horrible enough. I mean, at least that was an outside enemy, but now our own citizens are attacking our cities. There's the ongoing atrocity of human trafficking. It's right here in our backyard. We help support the Genesis Project in Seattle that rescues people from human trafficking. And if you saw one of John Stone Street's articles this week, of the 24,000 runaway teens and children in this country, it's believed that at least 1 in 6 of them are victims of sex trafficking. Then there's the ongoing battle with cancer and heart disease and the current COVID panic and our pandemic and now the smoke that's around us and, of course, even worse, the kidnappings, the rapes, the murders. Those are tragic realities no one can deny. And they're evidence that in spite of what some say, our world is not getting better and better. It's getting worse and worse. It's damaged. It's wrecked. It's evil. No wonder so many, maybe even somebody listening either in this room or remotely, you've begun to wonder, does he love me? Can I know this? And it's easy for us to begin to doubt that if we think of him as nothing but love, grace, mercy, soft, gooey, fuzzy warmness. In fact, I should confess right up front that even though this is a message on God's love, it's not a sentimental message to give you the warm fuzzies. This is going to be a message like every message from this pulpit. It's based on truth to help us think correctly. Because what we think about God is the most important thing about us. Our understanding of God will shape our thinking about everything else. So when we think about the love of God, it's necessary in these days to think as much about what it doesn't mean as what it does mean. For instance, God is not a deity who sits in his head, heaven, nodding his head and saying, no matter what, it just doesn't matter. Anything goes because, hey, I love you. That's not really love, because that's not really what's good for us. Our God doesn't say, my love is such that, boy, I'm just willing to overlook anything sinful that you do, whether it's a thought or a word or an action. Just, it doesn't matter because I love you. And while I'm at it, he's not saying, because I love you, nothing you do grieves my heart. I just love you so much, I don't even notice when you disobey me. Because, at least you're saved, whatever that means. That's just one of those incredibly sloppy thoughts Christians get today. God is not just love, grace, and mercy. He's also a God of justice. He's a God of compassion, yes, but he's also a God of righteousness. He's a God of forgiveness, yes, but he's also a God of truth. He's a God of patience, for sure, but he's also a God of holiness. He is sovereign. He is mysterious within his sovereignty. If you ever remove the mystery from your theology, you'll lose a lot of your theology. Because if you ever get to the point that you think God is not mysterious anymore and you can understand every nth degree about him, you're either the most arrogant person on earth or you've really diminished God. But if you think as you should think, there'll be a number of times in your life when you'll just simply have to back away and say, Lord, I don't get it. I don't understand. Let's begin our time in 1 John chapter 4. And while you're looking for that, lest you be tempted to question his love in the midst of our day and days gone by and days that are going to come in the future, let me just remind you very quickly about some of the things that God says in his word about his love. You saw one that was illustrated in the video. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him would not perish but would have eternal life. John 3:16. How about this one? God proved his love for us in that while we were still sinning, Christ died for us. How many of you would die for somebody that was spitting in your face at the time? Romans 5:8, by the way. Or here's this one. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. Ephesians 2:4-5. Or here's a good one. God our Father has loved us and through grace has given us eternal comfort and good hope. 2 Thessalonians 2:16. Or one very near where we're going to be in 1 John 4, verses 9 and 10. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent us his Son to be the atoning sacrifices for our sins. And I could just go on and on and on. Jesus loves me. This I know. Why? Because the Bible keeps telling me so. And he will love me until I die. He will. My situation notwithstanding, the smoke, the virus, whatever, that's not an indication God has fallen out of love with you. He still loves you. And so in 1 John 4, look at verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God because, notice this, God himself is love. When that says that God is love, it doesn't mean he just produces love or behaves lovingly. It means he defines it. He personifies it. This unconditional, the Greek word is agape here. It's the most self-giving, self-sacrificing form of love we know. Love, that kind of love, that level of love permeates who he is and everything he does. It's a giving, sacrificial, consistent love, all for the other. And yet it's compatible and it's complementary to all of his other attributes, such as holiness, righteousness, and all of the things that you know about him. But it's because of his love, that's the emphasis today. It's because of his love that he does everything he does, including choosing to call you into his family. Look at chapter 2, verse 29. Turn back a page in your scriptures. Look at verse 29. If you know that he is righteousness, and he is, you may be sure that everyone who does right has been born of him. See what love the Father has given us. You're sure of his righteousness. Be just as sure of his love. And the love the Father has given us allows us to be called the children of God, which is what we are. Through his love, he adopted you into his family. Now, just be honest. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, no out loud answers. But if you were God, would you have chosen you? I wouldn't have chosen me. Why would holy, infinite, sovereign, majestic, awesome creator God want me? I have nothing to offer him. His love caused him to do that. It's declared very clearly in the section we read. Go to Romans chapter 8. Remember this? We were in this a long time, so we're not going to spend a long time here today. But just as a review, how clearly this is set forth, this love of God, this love that's at work, verses 28 through 30, this love that's on display, verses 31 through 39. It's really two sections. And in each section, there's a summary verse, you may remember that, followed by an amplification of five things for each of those verses. We've been here recently. We're going to move quickly. The summary verse in the first section is verse 28. We know that all things work together, we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. And then you'll remember there are five declarations that follow that. God foreknew us, God predestined us, God called us, God justified us, God glorified us. And all of those are seen as completed facts, even though none of us are glorified yet. But because God has declared it so, it's as if it's already happened. Your future glorification in the eyes of God is a done deal, just like everything else. And it's all because he loved us and still loves us. Having loved us to the end, all of these things are securely in place. I can't explain it completely. And I can't convince you. I can't prove it to you. I can only declare that it's true from God's word. It all comes out of the 28th verse, which is the summary verse. When you come to the second section, the summary statement, verse 31, since God is for you, And since he is, based on that, there are five questions that follow, all hanging off of that statement, because God is for you, these things are true. You'll remember that. Go back to verse 28. Look at this summary verse. We know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God and who are called according to his purpose. Let me just remind you very quickly. First of all, this is not something we hope. This is something we know. Jesus loves me, this I imagine, this I hope, this I wish, this I dream. No, this is not something we hope or dream or fantasize. Observe how it begins. We know that this is true. Number two, God doesn't say he merely watches things from a distance. He says he causes them to work together towards something. We know that God causes. Your Bible may not insert that phrase, but the verb is in what's known as the causal stem, and it really should be understood that way. We know that God causes all things to go a certain direction. Don't get weak with that. And this is where some people get tripped up today. Well, if he's causing everything to work together to good, how come it's so terribly awful now? I mean, I can't explain it. Well, you know what the relief here is? Nobody asked you to explain it. I can't rationalize. Nobody asked you to rationalize. What you're asked to do is believe it, to accept it. That he has a plan and he's causing everything, including smoke in the atmosphere right now. He's causing everything somehow to work together towards a plan that he has in mind. Either that, or this is a lie and he's not sovereign, right? So you don't have to explain it. There are a lot of things I can't explain about God. How about you? You're asked to believe it. Number three, this doesn't say that some things work together or most things work together. It says all things, which again includes right now what seems to be among the worst of things. Okay? It doesn't say all things are good. It doesn't even say God causes all things. Don't get confused. Why did God cause this virus? I don't know that he did. It doesn't say God causes all things. It says he causes all things to work together towards a goal. Okay? God didn't cause a person to murder someone else. God didn't cause someone to kidnap someone else. God didn't cause cancer. God didn't cause war. Not all things are good. The Holocaust was not good. The treatment of the Dutch during the Boer War was not good. The tragedies that occur in your neighborhood right now are not good. The smoke in the air is not good. Pandemics are not good. Civil terrorism is not good. They're not caused by God. But what he does is he causes all things, including those things, somehow to work together for good. Or again, this is a lie and he's not sovereign. And where people get hung up in again is they, but I can't explain. Well, you know what? Nobody asked you to explain. No one's waiting with bated breath to hear your explanation of why there's a pandemic right now. We just go with what God says in his word, which tells us it all comes from him in terms of he has a purpose in it, and his purpose is driven by his love. And remember, it also says very quickly, and I know I'm getting kind of hung up here, but it doesn't say that all things work together for good for everybody, right? It says they work together for good for those who love God. Please observe. This is for those who love God and who are called according to his purpose. For them, all things work together for good. For those who are outside of Christ, this is not a promise they can claim. For them, everything isn't always culminating in good. I mean, let's face it, if you're outside of Christ, your eternity is hell, and what's good about that? That's why the world is filled with skeptics who take shots at God and at those who believe in God. You talk to me about a God who's loving? Well, look at what's going on. You're telling me there's a God who cares? Explain to me what just occurred. Well, here again, you can't explain it. But they don't love God, and so they're outside of his promise. And it doesn't say it works together for good for what we want. It says all things are caused by God to work together for good according to whose purpose? His. And sometimes you'll find that his purpose and your purpose are a little different. And so on the basis of what Paul has written here, he gives us five declarations regarding the plan of God from God's perspective, as God sits on his throne and looks down on all of this and deals with all of this and causes everything to work together for good according to those who are called according to his purpose and who are in his plan. And look at it very quickly. Those whom he foreknew, those whom he predestined, he foreordained. It doesn't mean he predestined you to become saved or not saved. It says he predestined you to be what? To be conformed to the image of his son. Don't get confused there. So he called you. Jesus himself said, nobody comes to me unless the Father draws him. You don't just come to God on your own initiative. He seeks you. He calls you. And then you have the free will to say yes or no. And if you say yes, look at what he did. He justified you. How loving is that? That's God saying at the moment of your salvation, all your sins are taken care of. Isn't that good? That's love, folks. You don't have to plead for righteousness. You don't have to buy righteousness. You don't have to pray for righteousness. You just simply come to the cross at the moment of your conversion and righteousness is declared for you. Whew. And then future, though it's written in present tense, you are glorified. Now you're not yet, but you will be. I think this is the most amazing of the group because the actual doing of it is yet future. Like Scripture says, it does not yet appear what we will be, but we know that when we see him, we will be like him. We're not yet glorified, but it's written here as if it's already done. God sees your glorification as a done deal. Next time you look in the mirror, say, I'm glorified. It'll take a lot of convincing, but God in his love sees you that way. John R.W. Stott put it so well. He says, here then is the apostles' series of five undeniable affirmations. God is pictured as moving irresistibly from stage to stage, from an eternal foreknowledge and predestination through a historical call and justification to a final glorification of his people in future eternity. It's like a chain of five links, each of which is unbreakable. And it's all because of God's love. That's the theme of this. Who can separate us from the love of God demonstrated in Christ Jesus, which is what accomplishes this? It's all about God and his love. Which is why you don't have to hang on and hope that, oh, if I'm good enough and if I do enough and if I'm nice enough and I get to the end, oh, he'll take me. He already has a hold of you and he's not going to let you go. Remember what Jesus said? You are in my hand. I am in the Father's hand. Who's going to get you out of there? John Campbell Sharp put it this way, let me no more my comfort draw from my frail hold of thee. In this alone rejoice with awe, thy mighty grasp of me. Thy purpose of eternal good let me but surely know. On this I'll lean, let changing mood and feeling come or go. Now that's old Scottish, and some of you are going, what? So let me help you with our good friend Dallas Holm, he put it this way. Jesus got a hold of my life, and he won't let me go. Jesus got into my heart, he got into my soul. I used to be oh so sad, but now I'm just free and glad because Jesus got a hold of my life, and he won't let me go. I don't wake up in the morning insecure. I wake up secure every morning. Not because of my grip on God, but because of Jesus' grip on me and the Father's grip on him. And because that grip is so tight, my glorification is already a done deal. Boy, that's called love. And you say, but I'm not worth that. No, you're not. It's not about our worth. Aren't you glad? How deep the Father's love for us, right? You just sang it. How vast, beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. Did you enjoy singing that? When was the last time you called yourself a wretch? It's good theology. We are wretches. We're sinners, just stinking sinners. Undeserving. And the reason it's so important to understand this is it just helps you to realize how profound God's love is. And because he loves us, and because we do have eternal souls that are so precious to him, Our Creator God of all things, while we were still spitting in His face and sinning, said to His Son of all people. I mean, to me, it'd make a little more sense if He said, Gabriel, I got bad news for you, son. You're going to go to the earth and you're going to die on a cross, okay? Because I'm just not going to ask my son to do that. But He said to His Son of all people, it's going to require your death to pay a penalty you don't owe that they deserve, and you're going to do it for Him, for them. And so He willingly leaves the glories of heaven to come here to this earth to die on the cross in order to pay my debt and your debt completely. Would you call that love? And so that now, as a wretch, I find myself declared righteous and justified and glorified. Which leads the apostle to announce in verse 31 what everything around you denies. The COVID virus, the smoke in the air, the economic struggles and all of that stuff. See verse 31? God is for us. Right? I had you do this before. Do it again. Say it with me. God is for us. Say that. And as much as this may bug you, I give you permission to rewrite the Bible a little bit and change the pronoun and say it like this. God is for me. You don't sound like you believe it. Say it again. God is for me. He's in favor of you. You know why? Because you're so wonderful? No, because He's so loving. You don't have to wonder and worry, will my good works outweigh my bad works when I die? I can already tell you, probably not. Because you probably lived a while before you ever became a Christian, so a lot of bad works piled up just there. And even as a Christian, you still pile up a few. So if you're hoping that your good works outweigh your bad, and that's what gets you in, sorry. It's because of His love for us. Remember, we are in His Son. His Son is in the Father. If the Father loves the Son as much as we know He does, and if I am in the Son and the Son is in Him, then His love for me is true as well. That's pretty secure. And then there are those wonderful questions. We're not going to get them all, but look at the bookend questions. First of all, in verse 31, what then are we to say about all these things, all the things about being foreknown, justified, predestined, called, glorified, and all that. What can we say to that? Well, since God is obviously for us, who can be against us? Remember? And you're thinking, well, boy, I have a lot of enemies, starting with Satan and his demons. They top my list. That's who's against me. And then there are those in our world who carry out very God-despising, God-hating things. They're against me. I've got my own sin nature. That works against me. My neighbor over there keeps parking his rigs all over my yard. They're against me. The world and its system and all of its philosophy, they're against me. Remember what I said about this? That's not the issue. The issue is, since God is for you, who cares who's against you? Did you see the movie The Blind Side? I'd have loved to have played football with Michael Orr on my team. If Michael Orr is on your team, who cares who's on the other team? But this is even better than that. Because there's probably somebody that can take Michael Orr out. Ain't nobody can take God out. Since God is for me, who cares who comes against me? And then the other book in question, verse 35, who, what, can anything separate us from this love of God? Since it's all bound up in His love, Jesus loves me, this I know. Is there anything that can ever separate me from that? Since His love is the basis of all of this, and that's why God is for me, it's because of His love, is there ever a possibility that I might be torn away, torn out of, removed from that love? In fact, will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword or COVID or smoke in the atmosphere or anything, will anything? I mean, listen, you know, just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you're immune from stuff like that. Christians have died from COVID. God doesn't isolate His children from their times. So when those things go on, and when your dear Christian friend gets COVID or even dies from COVID, as we had a dear friend do, well, does that mean that that person somehow found themselves separated from the love of God? Verse 37. Absolutely not. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who, what? Tolerates us, right? No. Loves us. Loves us. Even though we're sheep, remember last time? We are sheep who more than conquer. Sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? I mean, can you imagine? You go up to a really nice home, and you see on the gate it says, "Beware of the guard sheep." I've never heard of security sheep. The police are not going out in the riots with their sheep on leads saying, "You all better go home or we're going to set our sheep on you." It's because sheep have no strength. They're not a threat. But we're sheep, and yet we more than conquer. Why? Because of us? No, through him, God, who loves us. Remember, since God is for us, who cares who's opposing us? And then that gets on a roll, and Paul really goes off on that, concluding with, I am convinced at the end of verse 39 that nothing in all of creation can separate us from the love of God, the love that was demonstrated in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Absolutely nothing can come between you and the love God has for you. Absolutely nothing. Is that good news in our troubled times? Is that good news for the one who is just diagnosed with a serious or even terminal illness? Is that good news for you who feel overwhelmed with the way school is going? We've got a few people attached to schools in this room. It's not fun. It's not easy. But it doesn't mean you become separated from God's love. Wow. Boy, cling to this. This is ours to claim. God loves you. How do I tap into that? Maybe you're thinking. I'm glad you asked. Go back to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, very quickly. Oh, I wish we had more time. I always wish that. Let me wind down with the greatest. Paul just said it. God demonstrated his love towards us. Let's look at what that really means. Back in 1 John chapter 3, interesting how this is another 3:16 statement in the Bible. Don't really think that's an accident. 1 John, not the gospel, 1 John 3:16. We know love, meaning God's love, by this. That he laid down his life for us. Who did? Jesus, the second member of the Trinity. We know that ultimate demonstration of God's love for us this way, that he laid down his life for us. We know love because we've seen it in that. Verse 23, and so this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and then also love one another just as he commanded us. The word believe here, again, people get a little sloppy with this. In the New Testament, it's always a word of action. It's not just an intellectual agreement. Oh, yeah, I believe that. Believe means you do something about it. Like when you walked in this room this morning and you located your chair and you sat down. How many of you took the time to pick the chair up, turn it around, look at the bottom, check it all out, and make sure it's really put together well before you sat in it? Anybody do that? I didn't see anybody do that. You know what all you people did? You got great faith. You just came in here and sat in a chair, believing it would hold you up. See, behavior is what proves belief. If you'd have checked it all out, then you don't really have belief. You have a lot of doubt. But you just came in, located a chair, and sat in it, simply believing it would hold you up. It's the same way in Scripture when it talks about believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not just saying, oh, yeah, I agree. Yeah, that sounds good. Because the Bible says even the demons believe on that level. And they also tremble in their belief, and yet their eternity will be in hell. So it's more than just understanding. It's action. It's what do you do with it? So here you're told to do something about your belief in the name, meaning the whole identity, the mission, the purpose, the character, the agenda of Jesus, everything about him. When you choose to believe in him that way, you're not just saying, I agree with the Bible. It means you understand he really is the perfect Son of God, Redeemer, Lord, Master, Creator, the one who died for me. And I'm going to adjust my whole life to him. That's why John writes in chapter 4 of this same letter, verse 9, quoted it for you earlier, God's love was revealed among us like this. He sent his only Son into the world that we might live through him, meaning act on it. And in this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Wow, that's love. Knowing we deserve hell, he offered us heaven. Knowing we deserve to die on a cross and worse, he sent Jesus to do it for us. Knowing we deserve eternal punishment, he offers us eternal life. Knowing we really deserve to try to work things out on our own the best we can, and if you somehow can really achieve everything that God expects in his righteousness, well, I guess he'll let you into heaven, but for most of us, we'll never get there. Knowing we deserve that, he said, look, I'll take care of it for you. I'll declare you righteous if you'll just believe in the death of my Son. Finally, go to the Gospel by John, chapter 3, very quickly. And as you're turning to that, I love the hymn of John Robinson, love with everlasting love, led by grace that love to know, Spirit breathing from above, thou hast taught me it is so. Oh, this full and perfect peace. Oh, this transport all divine. In a love, listen, in a love that cannot cease, I am his and he is mine. That's God saying, listen, I love you. I love you. Here's how Jesus put it, John chapter 3, verse 14. He said, just like Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. That whoever believes in him will have eternal life. So there's an action born out of faith, just like in the wilderness. The people couldn't sit in their tent and say, yeah, I'm pretty sure that golden serpent represents healing, and I'll just sit here in my tent and believe that. Remember what they had to do? They had to do something to prove their faith. They had to walk and look at the thing. That's why Jesus uses this. There's an action coupled with faith. James talks about that a lot in his letter. If the action's not there, the faith is probably dead. So if you believe with that kind of belief, you will have eternal life. For, listen, God so loved the world. He so loved the world that he gave his only Son. How good is that? He didn't loan him to you. He didn't sell him to you, because who can afford him? He gave him to you. I mean, I'm assuming you're part of the world. You look like you are. Why? Because he loves you. And it's because he loves you so much, he wants relationship with you. That's why he created you in the first place. But sin has destroyed that relationship, and so that relationship needs to be reconciled. And in God's economy, the only way to reconcile this broken relationship between you and him is that somebody has to die. But instead of asking you to die because you can't pay your own penalty, he had his own Son come and die so that you could be reconciled to God. I mean, wow. God in his great love for you, again, you can replace God so loved the world with God so loved and write your name in there. It's okay. That he gave you his only Son. So that what? So that you wouldn't have to perish in hell in an eternal perishing, a perishing that never ends, a dying that never ends in death, but an eternal suffering in hell. You wouldn't have to have that. You could have eternal life with God. Instead of having suffering unending in hell, you have life unending with God because of what God did for you, because God loves you that much. All you have to do is believe in that sense of real belief, not just head belief, but life belief. And so that's just the question this morning. Do you believe on that level? Do you believe in Him? I mean, truly, really, sitting in the chair without looking, believe in Him. His character, His nature, His purpose, His identity, His plan, His mission, His calling, His gifting. That's the only way to have eternal life with God. It's not just a head belief. It's a life belief. You can't be changed from the outside in. You've got to be changed from the inside out. But once you're changed from the inside, it does come out. And it's all because of God's love. So there's good news and there's bad news as we wrap this up. The good news is God doesn't wait for you to be good so He can then love you. God doesn't wait until you get really, really cleaned up and really, really got your act together. And then He says, oh, you're all right. I think I'll love you. He loves you even before He redeems you. How good is that? While you're still sinning. And then when you come to Him by faith, He continues to love you even though at times you still fail, because you are in His Son. And the link between you and God is the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's an unbreakable link. Remember, what can separate us from the love of God? And the answer is absolutely nothing. Okay? That's the good news. You don't have to earn this, buy this, achieve this, merit this. It's just there. It's there before your salvation because Christ has already died, so it's there. And God says, come get it. And once you come get it, it's always there. As God is then transforming you into the image of Christ, and your failure doesn't make Him say, oh, that's it, I don't love you anymore. That never happens. The bad news is, if you only go so far as to say, well, yeah, I believe in Jesus, so I'll pray to receive Him, but I'm not going to change anything. I don't want Him to be the Lord of my life. I just want to feel good about it. Well, then you're missing it. You're missing it altogether. Like James says, you say you have faith, but you don't have the accompanying works. I'll tell you what, you don't even have the faith then. It's kind of a prayer of paraphrase, but that's what he's saying. If the Lord Jesus doesn't change your life, He's not even in your life. It's just that simple. If you choose not to truly, truly sitting in the chair without checking it, just devoting yourself to it, if that faith is not there, you don't have the life. If you don't have the life, you don't have the Son. And if you don't have the Son, then you do have hell to face. But the good news there is you still have the choice of coming to the Son because there's still breath in your lungs. You can have this if you'll just come as Christ describes. Remember, I'm telling you what you need to know, not what you want to hear. The secret is, what have you really done with the Lord Jesus at the cross? This is the ultimate demonstration of God's love. Believe it. Believe it in the way Scripture tells you to believe it. And it's yours. Let's pray. If you're like me, you've sung it since you were just the littlest of children. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. My whole life I've sung that. So why as an adult do I sometimes doubt it? Just because I can't explain it all, and I can't, doesn't mean it's not true. I'll tell you what's true. God loves you. He demonstrated that love for you in Christ Jesus even while you were still sinning, And he still loves you now. And I know that's true because the Bible tells me it's true. And I know he loves you just the same. If you've never come to him by true, believing, life-changing faith, do that right now, right where you're sitting. Just come in faith. If you've already done that, then just cling to the truth. Remember, God is for me. God so loved me that he gave his only son for me. On either end of this, just trust that. Trust that you can come to him because of his love and receive his gift of eternal life. On the other side, just keep trusting that his love is unchanging. Just trust him. We sang it, Our Father, we will not boast in anything. No gift, no power, no wisdom. We just boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. I don't understand it, that I should gain from his reward. I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you. We praise you. We glorify you. We love you. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing our closing song.
Oh, my God. this out.
You just do it so well.
Thank you, Lord, so very, very much for this opportunity to gather as your family. This is your church. This is your house. This is the place that we are allowed prayerfully to gather and to worship you, and we just thank you for this opportunity. Now, as we go out, continue to remind us that there are those who need to hear of you, about you, and learn to believe not just in you, but on you. In Jesus' name, amen.